take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone.
You're listening to America Off the Rails with Double R right here on the Common Ground Media Network. You are now tuned into the Bush Leagues of Talk Radio, right here on the all-new K98 Talk.
All right, folks, good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you might be. I am Double R, and of course, this is America Off the Rails. This is our first show of February. It is February 3rd, 2014. Hope you guys tuned in and caught the special edition with JT broadcasting today. Can't get him to get on the microphone very often anymore, but when he does, it's usually something pretty good. I'm actually going to have to go back and listen to it later because I just finished my shift at my day job and just finished up dinner. Now, before we get into the meat of the show, I do have to say, did anybody else watch the Super Bowl? Just saying. Yeah, we're going to spend the first little bit of the show talking about that, so let's do it right. All right, now I have to admit, I was pleasantly surprised by the outcome, and me, like much anybody else in radio who I've heard talking about it today, kind of knew the outcome after the first 12 seconds of gameplay. All of a sudden, Mr. Peyton Manning, star of the Denver Broncos, who I will now lovingly refer to as the Denver My Little Ponies, stepped up to make an adjustment. Suddenly the center lets the ball fly, and all you see is Peyton Manning with the face only his mother could love, looking like, holy crap, what just happened? And the game went downhill from there. So yeah, I used to, for those of you who've been listening for a while, you know I used to live in Seattle, so I was quietly pulling for the Seahawks and a house full of Broncos fans until the game went sideways for the Broncos from the get-go. Then, of course, I'm like laughing and joking and making jokes on Facebook, and the lovely wife the whole time was like, that's not funny! This game sucks! Like, I guess that depends on your point of view, because I thought it was kind of entertaining. Granted, I was pretty much bored with it by halftime, and by then I was basically just making fun of the Denver Broncos over and over and over again on Facebook. You kind of felt a little bit sad for Mr. Manning, because, you know, number one offense in the league meets number two defense in the league, and if, instead of bringing the Broncos, they bring the My Little Ponies. Because, yeah, I don't know what happened, but their game wasn't in it from the get-go. The only thing I can honestly think is, you know, these are both states where marijuana is legalized in certain degrees. I'm kind of thinking that maybe the Seahawks could toke a little better than the Broncos and keep up, because I'm pretty sure at least half the Denver Broncos were still high when they got on the field. I mean, come on. There was absolutely no help for that offense from the get-go. I mean, not to steal a phrase that I heard on the drive home, but one of the other hosts that I listen to on a regular basis on terrestrial radio was talking about how the entire offense needed hospice care because they were basically waiting to die. And that was pretty much how that entire game went. Now, of course, if you were a Broncos fan, that means that the Kleenex came out early, and all of a sudden you were looking for excuses like bad calls or blah, blah, blah. But for a Seahawk fans, it was a party from the first 12 seconds on. So, yeah. I have to admit, I didn't catch too many of the commercials because I was too busy making fun of Peyton Manning and the Broncos repeatedly and often. The couple that I did see, because I hear everybody talking about the Coca-Cola commercial, and me being the crappy Bush League radio host that I am, I haven't had a chance to pull it up before I started doing the show. I'm sure I probably could have found it on YouTube, but, you know, didn't want to spend the whole show talking about commercials. But the two that I thought were honestly pretty good, at least in my opinion, I didn't see the Coke commercial, so I'll reserve judgment. Maybe I'll download it and play it at the beginning of tomorrow's episode, depending on how much of it will translate well, since it's a video commercial and this is an audio show. But the two that I got a really big kick out of were the Muppets. I mean, come on. I'm a child of the 70s. Was through my formative years in the early 80s. and Muppets were a big thing. So the commercial with the Muppets, instant win for me, thought it was awesome. And then the Radio Shack montage commercial. Because again, that was a bunch of 80s stuff, like Alf made an appearance, saw Hulk Hogan for a minute there. And then, of course, there was the Budweiser Troop commercial, which I thought was really good. Of course, then again, unlike some people who frequent my Facebook pages, I actually like the fact that during major sporting events, we tend to give tributes to our troops, because without their sacrifices, we wouldn't be able to enjoy the things that we enjoy, including those particular sporting events. Now, one of the reasons I, of course, wanted to bring this up is I've heard some interesting things about the stuff going on before the game ever started. Like, for those of you who weren't lucky enough to be there, might want to rethink your definition of luck, because apparently if you drove yourself to the game, it was $100 to park. Yeah, you heard me right. Unless, of course, there was some interference. Of course, according to my relays, there's not, but we shall see. But yeah, it was $100 to park. Now you might think, hey, you know, for the day, that may not be too bad. Except it wasn't for the day. You pulled in, you parked, and you left your car there, because the $100 was for one in, one out. So, yeah. Good job, New York. Just saying. I mean, that's just crazy to me. You paid $100 to park. But, you know, who knows? So, yeah, I mean, that pretty much sums up my little short segment on the Super Bowl, because for those of you who know me, I am a football follower, not necessarily a football fan. I prefer college. Normally, I will pay attention to a game here and there if a team that I like is playing. And, of course, I typically follow the playoffs a little bit and, of course, the Super Bowl, so at least I can follow along with conversations. But I just wanted to point out that for those of you who were singing the praises of Peyton Manning all year, fat lot of good it did you, because apparently he's taken a page from the Romo playbook. Choke when it counts. Sorry. I'm a little bit of a Dallas Cowboys fan, too. There are three major teams that I tend to kind of root for. And that's going to be Dallas Cowboys, because I was born in Oklahoma. Spent up until I was a teenager here. And it was either the Cowboys or the Chiefs, and, yeah, never really been a Kansas fan for much of anything. So then we moved to Seattle, and of course I got to go see some of the games there for both the Seahawks and, of course, the Mariners. But back when I lived there, the Seahawks sucked. So anybody who went to the games in person was usually going to see the other teams that were playing. So I have to say, it was kind of thrilling last night to watch my teenage hometown's team kick butt. Then, of course, we moved to Delaware when I was 15. And for those of you who aren't familiar with Delaware, might want to look it up at a map. Bring a magnifying glass. It's one of the smallest states I have ever lived in. We actually went to field trips in other states. I was part of a setup crew for satellite broadcasting back in the day when it was just catching on. We won a grant from NASA. So basically, I was part of a team that went to other schools to set up for satellite viewing when space shuttles and other things would launch, like satellites and things like that. So yeah, there were a couple times I actually went to schools in Maryland as part of that team, and then as a reward for it, we actually got to take a field trip to the Naval Academy, which was really, really cool, because back in the day, I mean, come on, it was 80s, Top Gun was all the rage. I really, really, really wanted to be a fighter pilot. Didn't happen, but that's really, really what I wanted to do. So yeah, getting to spend the day at the Annapolis Naval Academy was awesome, and I had all these dreams, and then life said, yeah, whatever, buddy. So, yeah. But anyway, so yeah, if you've ever been or curious about Delaware, look it up. Bring a magnifying glass. The only way you're going to be able to see it. But the cool thing is, again, there are several states that are next door, so one of the teams that I kind of latched onto was the Philadelphia Eagles, or of course, if you're from Philly, they typically call them the Eagles. One other team I used to follow a lot was the 49ers, but once the guy that I really liked, which was the quarterback from the 80s, retired, I didn't really follow them very much, so the 49ers and the Eagles game was one of those ones where I was like, hey, whoever wins this one, I'm going to like the outcome because I kind of like both teams. And then the Eagles lost after they won against the 49ers. At least I think that was them. Anyway, I may be mixing up stuff right now and I don't have anything pulled up in front of me. So, but anyway, just to kind of give you a little bit of a rundown, that's my little screwed up, this is why I follow which teams I follow. Honestly, the 49ers was because of the Sega game, which had the first play-by-play announcers ever, which involved the 49ers, and I'm a video game junkie, always have been, always will be, and then of course the other three teams we've discussed, I gave you reasons as to why. Okay, so at this point, I think we're going to go ahead and take a little bit of a break. We do have quick little commercial I want to play. This one was put together by one of the other hosts, but I heard it and I kind of liked it, so figured we'd go ahead and play it today. Gonna go ahead and take a little bit of a break. We will be right back.
Tuned into the Bush Leagues of Talk Radio, right here on the all-new K98 Talk.
Hi, this is Denny C. for the Family Factor, praying that this new year will bring more strength, joy, hope, and love to you and your family. This show is about looking deeply into the modern-day issues that affect your family and mine, so please tune in each weekday here on K98Talk.com, and I hope you'll get some answers to the factors within your family.
Over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
All Alright, folks, and we are back. Hope you enjoyed that little commercial and, of course, the red pill, blue pill opening that I play from time to time, only because this is going to be one of those shows. Again, the only thing I try to do is bring you the truth as I see it. It is up to you to interpret it or to research it if you don't feel I've done enough of that. Now, before we get started, the reason this has come up is because, for those of you who don't know, I currently live in the state of Oklahoma. We have been in the throes of some winter weather over the last couple of days, and apparently it's going to continue. For those of you in the Oklahoma area, you may want to make sure you tune in to your weather, whatever source you use for weather this evening, because apparently at about 1 o'clock this morning, we are supposed to get anywhere from 1 to 10 inches of snow, depending on where you are in the state. Okay, so that being said, when the snow started falling here yesterday, some interesting YouTube videos started coming up that people were finding. Some of them not from here yet. If we get the snow I'm expecting us to get, I may test it in the morning and see if it does happen here. Some of them from the Virginia area. And the question I have to ask you, though, is the same one that I do ask from time to time. Do you honestly trust our government? And there's a reason I'm asking. If you haven't yet, you may want to Google or YouTube search Strange Snow. You'll find several videos, only a couple of which that I've seen, but they both yield kind of the same results. People bring in snow from outside. They then pack it rather tightly, expose it to a heat source. Most of the time it's a lighter of some sort. And the thing that you would expect to see is not what you see. You know, I don't know how many of you did this when you were kids, but I did. Basically, you pack a snowball and you grab a lighter. Yes, I used to smoke as a child. I was a bad boy, but that's okay. So yes, I did have access to a lighter. Parents didn't know that at the time, but I had access to a lighter. So basically, one of the things we used to do, because back in the day, it would... Okay, I'm telling on myself here, but let me give you some backstory. So you take a little snowball, you pack it really tight, you take a lighter, you melt it. What happens to ice or snow when it melts? It starts turning into water. At least it's supposed to. So then, as you're melting it, you repack it with your hand to get it even tighter. So basically, you're making an ice cube. Then you take more snow, put it around the hard core that you just made, and you save those snowballs for the people that tick you off in the middle of a snowball fight. Okay, so we've already established before I'm not a very nice person. Yes, I did this quite often, but that's okay. So anyway, so the reason I bring this up is because several times as a kid I did this, whether it was to make evil snowballs or just because. And you pack a snowball, you hold it under a light or heat source of some kind, and you start seeing little water droplets come off. So some of you by now, because I've spent at least a couple of minutes going over this, are like, why the heck is he talking about this? Okay, so again, if you haven't yet, at some point, preferably not while the show is on, because you may lose me. Some of you are like, that's why I'm doing it right now. But that's okay. So anyway, so Google or YouTube search Strange Snow. Again, you'll see people doing the same thing I used to do when I was a kid. A few different videos of it. They'll pack some snow pretty good. They'll hold it to a lighter. No water. None. There's one video where he kind of starts out with his lighter on high heat, so you can actually see it start charring and turning black instead of turning into water. There's one that I thought was interesting because I was like, maybe that's partly why. So there's another video that I found today, and basically she starts with her lighter on low heat, holding it, no char marks, but again, no water. None. So she turns the lighter up, thinking, hey, maybe if I get it a little hotter. Still doesn't melt. It burns, complete with char marks. Each of the videos that I've seen, when heat is applied to the snow, they begin complaining of an odor that smells a lot like burning plastic. This is the stuff that's coming from our snow. So, two things come to mind. And I've seen people give conclusions that would support both. One is geoengineering. For those of you who don't know what that's kind of a fringe movement in science that's only partially being looked at as legitimate, where basically because of in the 60s and 70s, the global cooling fear, scientists started setting about ways to basically geoengineer the planet. Most people, if it was anywhere else, like say Mars, would call it terraforming. But since it's already here, basically it's just got another word of which is basically called geoengineering. Basically trying to keep the atmosphere and the climate on Earth as close to what it was in the 60s and 70s as possible before they started, of course, being afraid of global cooling. And then, of course, because we'd actually been tracking weather pattern data for the last several decades, they then started becoming afraid of global warming. Which, speaking of which, if anybody's wondering, you know, again, about 10 years or 15 years ago or so, some guy named Al Gore, was it 15 or 5? I don't know. Anyway, some time ago, Al Gore basically said that by now there would be zero polar ice caps. Yet, remember, a few months ago, there was a ship that was in the polar region to study the melting ice that got stuck in the not-so-melting ice. Okay, I only bring that up because, again, one of the main points of this show is, do you really trust your government? And Al Gore was a big part of our government for quite some time, and yet he basically got rich off of what is coming to be known as one of the biggest farces of all time to anyone who's willing to pay attention, which is global warming. You think I'm wrong? Go ahead and email me and tell me why. It's RRRK98Talk.com. I'll even read your email on the air, and then I'll tell you what I thought about what you said. So hit us up. You can also reach me anytime at my Twitter account, which is @R_OKC, with, of course, the @ in front of the double. You can also find the show page on Facebook, which is America Off the Rails, or America Is Coming Off the Rails, www.facebook.com/AmericaIsComingOffTheRails. Again, the page does take a little bit of a different tact on the page. I tend to try to be a little more upbeat and hopeful. On the show, I just tell you exactly how I feel, which is why one is America Is Coming Off the Rails and the other one is America Is Off the Rails, because I gotta tell you, folks, we're pretty much already there. So, again, reasons why I do not trust my government. And I will give you some recent examples here in just a second. Actually, let's go ahead and start doing that now, and then I'll go ahead and move on to other things that I wanted to talk about. You want to know why I don't trust my government? Let me let you listen to this guy, and then you can tell me why I don't trust my government.
I want to make a distinction between a universal plan versus a single-payer plan, because those are two different things. A single-payer plan would be a plan like Medicare for All or the kind of plan that they have in Canada, where basically government is the only person, is the only entity that pays for all health care. Everybody has a government-paid-for plan, even though depending on which country, the doctors are still private or the hospitals might still be private. In some countries, the doctors work for the government and the hospitals are owned by the government. But the point is that government pays for everything, like Medicare for All. That is a single-payer plan. I have not said that I was a single-payer supporter because, frankly, we historically have had a employer-based system in this country with private insurers, and for us to transition to a system like that, I believe, would be too disruptive.
Okay, so let's hang on right there for a second, because you just heard him say he is not a proponent of single payer because he feels it would be detrimental to our system. That is pretty much what he just said. Am I right? Okay. Let's roll the next part.
The challenge is, how do we get the federal government to take care of its business? I happen to be a proponent of a single-payer universal health care plan.
All right, did you hear that? America,
the wealthiest country in the history of the world, spending 14% of its gross national product on health care, cannot provide basic health insurance to everybody.
I have not said that I was a single payer supporter.
I happen to be a proponent of a single payer universal health care plan.
So yeah, if you'll notice there in the editing, I took a minute and let you hear the whole thing, let you hear both parts, and then we edit it at the very end just to let you hear the last two bits, which basically make this man a liar. I mean, this is akin to the same crap that Romney got crucified over during last year's election, because he said one thing in public while saying another thing privately. That's what just happened here. You don't believe me? Go find it on your own. We are not a high-budget show here, ladies and gentlemen. I have to find things through sources that you have access to. So you can see the same thing that I just played. I've even seen, since I did the editing, there is now a couple of them out there that actually have the editing done and tied to video. Not mad about that. Not at all. I just thought it was kind of interesting. But yeah, so I have to ask you again, do you trust your government? Because I got to tell you, right now your government's lying to you in every way possible. We are so busy, focused on day-to-day minutia, that we don't realize that neither side gives a crap about us anymore. We are a means to an end. Care to take a guess as to what that end is? Them keeping their power. That's all it's about anymore. The lobbyists want to keep their power. The politicians want to keep their power. The corporate fat cats want to keep their power. And we're all stuck in the middle, waiting for somebody to come to our rescue and fix it, when each and every single one of us have the power and the ability to do that on our own. We just choose not to see it. I'm no different than any of you. This started as a hobby. I had some friends involved in radio who heard it and said, hey, this is better than I thought it was going to be. So this is what we're going to do. I am John Q. Public, just like you. That's all I am. All I do is I spend a few minutes a day going over news articles. I form opinions, and I try to let you know what they are. I'm not even saying, because I know some of you right now are going, well, you may think you're just like me, but there's no way I could be on the air. Too nervous. You don't think I'm nervous every single time I hit the button? Not that I'm saying that that's something that you should do, but there are plenty of ways that you can get involved on your own level, in your own time, and in a way that maybe nobody else has even thought of. So if there's something that you're interested in trying to do, even if it's on just a local level, find a way to get involved. Find a campaign that you support. Give them a call. Tell them you're willing to go hand out flyers. Tell them you're willing to make phone calls. Do whatever it is that you can do to try to make a difference. Because here's where we're losing, folks. Those of us with conservative ideals, or even libertarian ideals, which are more fiscally conservative and more socially, yeah, as long as what you're doing doesn't affect me, why should I care? We're losing. And we're losing because the other side is completely militant. And we're losing because we've had faith in the people that said they felt the same way that we do when we send them to Washington, and then we send them to Washington, and they get chewed up and spit out by the machine. So I ask you again, do you trust your government, and if so, why? Are you living in Denver or Washington, the state and can suddenly now partake where you couldn't before. And does that suddenly explain why your senses are dulled and you're no longer paying attention? Both sides suck. Honestly, right before I went to or came on air, and I wish I would have known about it ahead of time because I might have actually postponed the show, I got a phone call from an automated system wanting to know if I wanted to take part in Mary Fallon's telephonic town hall. That intrigued me. If I'd had any way to tie the phone into it, I might have been doing that while talking to you guys. Sadly, I'm not that high-tech yet. But we will get there eventually. But it would have been nice to hear, because she did her State of the State address today. Another thing I haven't yet had a chance to review, so that will probably be something that we will talk about at some point this week. I do also have the entire State of the Union address that I'm basically picking apart as we speak, mainly because by the time I'm ready to talk about it, I want to be able to tell you everywhere that the man was basically lying through his teeth. Because that's what they do anymore. It doesn't matter which side they are. They tell you what they want to hear to get you to sit down, shut up, and stop paying attention. It really is that simple. That's all they do anymore. I mean, think about it. Look at it logically. Look at all the things that have gone on. If you look and go through the media for the last several weeks and months while we were talking about Phil Robinson and Justin Bieber, Miley Cyrus, and all the other things that are dangling in front of you with the media, and the whole world is falling apart. There are parts of old Soviet Russia, before everything broke up, that are basically in the middle of a struggle so bad I've heard it referred to as apocalyptic. And I'll be going over some of that stuff in a later show as well. But that's not what this show's about. This show is about here, now, today. We are being spoon-fed information, which is rather ironic, considering we live in the information age. You don't even have to watch TV anymore to get your news. You don't have to listen to radio. Not saying you shouldn't, because even I still listen to terrestrial radio, although I figure in about another decade or so that's going to be a thing of the past, and it'll all be internet-based. Hopefully I'm getting in on the ground floor of that, but we shall soon find out. Anyway, enough about me. But that's all I'm trying to say, is at this point, if you do trust the government, I only have to ask one question. Why? When they've lied to you over and over and over. Why? I mean, let's listen to the chief liar himself on another one that I thought was rather interesting. Okay, we're gonna go ahead and roll the clip.
Congress is doing right now is important. Unfortunately, right now the debate that's going on in Congress is not meeting the test of helping middle-class families. It's just they're not focused on you. They're focused on politics. They're focused on trying to mess with me. If Congress doesn't pass this debt ceiling in the next few weeks, the United States will default on its obligations. That's never happened in American history. Basically, America becomes a deadbeat.
Okay, guys, I've got to go vote. We are voting on the budget today. It's a sad state of affairs. We just voted to increase the debt limit. The U.S. total debt at this point exceeds $8 trillion. That's 8 trillion with a T. So we've got to get our fiscal house in order here in Washington. I'm not sure it's going to happen under the current leadership in Congress.
Okay, so again, in the category of do you trust your government, maybe I should have named this show a little differently. Maybe why the hell do you trust your government? The second bit was from then-Senator Obama lambasting the fact that under President Bush the debt ceiling was raised. Then, of course, before that, we have now President Obama lambasting Congress for not wanting to raise the debt ceiling. Anybody else getting tired of the fact that politicians seem to be able to talk out of both sides of their mouth and never seem to get called for it anymore? Unless, of course, they're Republican. You know, I guess I will talk about something about the State of the Union address before we do the breakdown, probably on either Wednesday or Thursday. After the State of the Union address, of course, I'm browsing Facebook like I normally do. Someone that I know basically had posted, go Obama, get those damn Republicans. And I'll be the first one to tell you, I'm not a fan of Republicans or Democrats at this point. I am probably one of the more confusing people ideologically that you'll ever meet. I am a Christian, I am a conservative, but at the same time, most social things, I tend to find myself to be more of a libertarian, because if it doesn't affect me directly, I really don't care what you do. It's none of my business. I'm an adult, you're an adult, let's act like adults and move on. That's kind of how I live my life. I don't try to judge anyone. I often fail. Who doesn't? But I do my best not to. And if I do, I typically find a way to apologize for it when I realize I've done it. But I try to live my life exactly how I just told you. I'm an adult, you're an adult, let's act like adults. And it really is that simple. If what you're doing doesn't affect me directly, I really could care less. As long as you're not making me look at it on a daily basis. Now that is where my libertarian leanings kind of stop. Because one of the issues that I have, especially in this day and age, and you can call me whatever you want to call me, it doesn't change anything. If the folks that were involved in this same-sex marriage thing would basically just quit trying to push quite so hard and take the civil union and run with it and quit trying to make such an issue out of all of it, it would be over. Because here's the thing, folks, and this is the thing nobody wants to tell you. And this is another reason why, in some ways, I blame the government, and in other ways, I blame loudmouth people who just want attention. There are plenty of people, because I've checked into it, who've basically found ways to draw up legal contracts once they are living with someone of the same sex that allows them access to property, allows them access to medical, and everything else. And it's not called a marriage. And I know what some of you are thinking is, oh, well, the Jews don't have a problem with gay marriage. Really, then why isn't their ceremony when they perform it with homosexuals called a marriage ceremony? The same thing happens in, I believe it's the Episcopalian Church, which is one of only Protestant denominations that recognizes homosexual unions. But it's not called a marriage. It's called a union ceremony. Quit trying to change the definition of words just because you want to see how much trouble you can cause. This is the thing that concerns me. I do not have an issue with whoever you as a person want to spend the rest of your life with. One, as long as they are able to make decisions, and two, they are of legal age, I really don't care who you spend your time with. But don't walk into somewhere and say, because of this, you need to do this, and then get mad when somebody says, no, I'm sorry, I don't agree with that choice. I'm sorry, you can say it's not a choice all you want, you can tell me I'm backwards. I'm sorry, it's a choice. I've met, and remember, this is from the guy who spent quite a few years in that community protecting them. There are not very many homosexual men or women that I've met that don't have children. I'm sure the number is probably bigger than I realize, but in my small sphere, most of the gay people that I talk to on a regular basis had children, and they had them the natural way. So at some point, they tried things the normal way. Sorry, I'm just saying it how it comes out. You don't like it, I don't care. And then they decided they didn't like it. So they decided to do it the homosexual way. I'm not judging you for it, but don't try to shove it down my throat. I don't want to hear about it. I don't want to see it. I'm tired of the token gay guy on every freaking TV show I like to watch anymore. We know it's there. We know you're there. I don't have to see it every time I turn on a TV. I'm sorry. That's just how I feel, and I'm not hiding how I feel about it anymore. You don't like me? I don't care. Not judging you for it. Not saying I think you're... I'm not saying I think it's nasty or gross or anything else. Because personally, what I think about it doesn't matter. What you think about it matters. But that doesn't mean, just like with anything else, that I want to be bombarded with it. That's just like half the time anymore. At 7 o'clock in the morning when I see commercials with women running around in Victoria's Secrets crap. I'm a straight guy and half the time I don't want to see that early in the morning. So of course I don't want to see the stuff that I don't agree with any time of day. Just like I don't want to see softcore porn on NBC. And that's what a lot of stuff's turning into. They've got to see just how far they can push it. It's just like with Miley. She's basically the Madonna of the new millennium. Except when Madonna was pushing the envelope was a lot bigger. Now the envelope's gotten really small because it's been pushed about as far as it can be pushed. Everything's always got to be about shock value. The problem with everything always being about shock value is the government knows that. And they know how easy it is to get you stirred up. I've said it before on Finding Common Ground when Dave and I used to host that show quite a bit. It's called bread and circuses, folks. They've done it ever since the Roman Empire. When things aren't going well, you put on a show and you make a distraction and you make everybody feel better for as long as the show's going on. And when that show's over, there's another one shortly thereafter. The problem is that nobody's caught on to is the fact that we are now in a 24/7 information age empire. So there's never a time that you can't go somewhere and find something to entertain you. There's Netflix. Roku. Speaking of which, we're on Roku now. It's being beta tested. Not sure if it's been put out in the open market yet. But we are on Roku. You can find stuff from 98FM.com, which is the music side of the show, or music side of the house. You can also find stuff at 98from98talk.com, which is the talk side of the house. And of course, anytime you want to catch any archives, our website's been undergoing some maintenance due to some issues. But if you like catching archives, you can always go to speaker.com. Search both 98FM and 98talk.com. And, of course, you can subscribe to the RSS feeds. That way, anytime there's a broadcast, your system will automatically download it and you can check it out. Or, again, if you have a Roku and you want to check us out, you may want to try running the search. See if you can find it there and go from there. And when I know for sure it's been posted into the published side of things, I will definitely let you guys know. But, so, anyway... Where was I? Oh yeah, do you trust your government? And if so, why the hell do you? Some interesting things I've been pulling up during the couple of little play breaks we've had here. So, just to make sure that you guys can see exactly how crazy things are getting... this, of course, is from an article out of Washington from the Wall Street Journal. The head of the International Monetary Fund on Monday called for greater collaboration among the world's central banks, citing the threat of turmoil spreading through the global financial system. central banks. Dumbest thing ever. I mean, why do we even have a centralized bank in this country? I can tell you why. And then you can look it up for yourself as well. It's called control. Just saying. Everything the government does is about control. I mean, think about it. We had the Social Security Act. There's a reason I bring that up, too. Because at the time it was passed, nobody liked it. Nobody wanted it. Kind of sound like something else. Maybe the Affordable Care Act? Of course, once it was passed, there was really no way to get rid of it. So people just said, eventually it'll be okay. But they never really figured out. And only a small percentage still seem to understand is that Social Security, otherwise known as government-funded retirement, is the biggest Ponzi scheme ever. Oh yeah, but Mr. O-blah-blah-blah, he's not stopping there. And again, we'll go into it in a little more detail. Probably, again, hopefully Wednesday will be when I can have all of that stuff put together so we can kind of go over some bits of the State of the Union. But one of the things I did want to kind of pull to the surface now is the MIRA. Or the MIRA. So, let's just make sure that we're all on the same page here. You already have money coming out of your check, being paid into a system called Social Security that's supposed to pay you when you retire and also give you some money towards paying for your funeral expenses. Okay. So, not only do we already have that, now Mr. Obama has decided that we need a government-funded retirement program called the MIRA. Okay, for anyone who's wondering or hadn't been paying attention, the MIRA is something kind of a bastardized IRA. Basically, you can set a certain amount of money to come out of your check every week or every payday. And the government then basically supposedly invests your money in T-bonds, otherwise known as treasury bonds, which are one of the lowest possible yield accounts ever contrived by the government. So yeah, again, we'll go into it more specifically later in the week, because I have some clips I want to play with it. But I just want to kind of give you a heads up. This is why you shouldn't trust your government. They're already taking money out of your check. They're taking more money out of your check than they've ever taken before. And yet, now they're finding ways for you to voluntarily give them more money out of your check. When in all actuality, if you really, really wanted a retirement fund, it doesn't really cost that much to get an IRA started. But again, it's all about control. Because they may tell you they're going to take your money and they're going to put it into an almost no-yield treasury bond account. What do you think they're really probably going to do with it? I mean, seriously, what do you think they're going to do with it? they're going to do the same thing they did with Social Security money. They're going to put it into the system. They're going to use it for their pork, for their waste, for their crap that none of us want in the first place. And then when it comes time for you to retire, they're going to be like, oh, well, we'll let your grandkids pay for that because, yeah, we don't have your money anymore. Yet another reason why I don't trust my government is the fact that we have basically nationalized education at this point. Now, of course, you can take this with a grain of salt. This is from the Daily Caller. At an event on Friday sponsored by a leftist think tank, former Massachusetts Education Secretary Paul Revile, or as I like to call him, Paul Revile, called Common Core critics a tiny minority and asserted that the children belong to all of us. Yeah, you heard that right. The children belong to all of us. Mr. Revile, sorry, I'm going to start doing that from now on, also claimed that opponents of Common Core are against any academic standards. Reports from CNSnews.com. To be sure, there's always a small voice, and I think these voices get amplified in the midst of these arguments of people who were never in favor of standards in the first place and never wanted to have any kind of testing or accountability, and those voices get amplified, Revile declared. Revile, a Harvard professor who served as Secretary of Education under current Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick, then bashed federalism and suggested that children are communal property. Communal property. Think about that for a second. And he isn't the first person that said this. When we take another commercial break here in a second, I may actually see if I can find the other clip. Because he is not the first person who said anything about the fact that children in this day and age should belong to all of us. I don't know about you, but from some of these kooky bastards I've been seeing, I don't want them anywhere near my kids. Just saying. Alright, we have hit getting pretty close to the two-thirds of the way through for this one. I think this one's probably going to cut around 90 minutes. I'm going to start working on trying to get closer to the two-hour mark, but been doing a lot of work behind the scenes and trying to get training settled for the day job, so I'm going to kind of ease back into things a little bit, I think. We will be right back.
We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains. We
were giving the Obama administration the big ones up right from the middle finger. Common Ground Radio with Double R.
Hey, folks. I don't know about you, but I always feel like there just isn't enough time in the day. You know, one of those not enough hours in the day kind of things. But, you know, working full-time, raising a family, trying to start a company, I'm sure some of you can relate. So, what can we do about it, I guess is my question. Short of hijacking Doc Brown and having him show you the secrets to the DeLorean, what if I told you there was a way where we could get you more energy for the hours that you had in your day instead of worrying about finding more time in your day? Anyway, I found the information through my independent beach body life coach, Miss Sherry Britt. You can find her information online at www.beachbody.com/SherryBritt1. Basically, I have to tell you, folks, I haven't been doing it for very long, but it's working. It's one of those total commitment kind of things. I'm using a program called Shakeology. Basically, it's a meal replacement. Think SlimFast, but better. And also, I have one of Sean T's workout videos. We're doing T25 right now. Started that a couple of days ago. Have to admit, I'm old, I'm fat, and it's painful, but I feel better. And it's one of those things where I'm doing it at my own pace. There's also nutrition plans involved in a lot of these packages if you go for the whole thing. So it's what they like to call a challenge pack. I call it a bundle offer. Basically, it gets you the Shakeology, video of your choice, and a diet and exercise plan all rolled into one. Basically, it's just one of those things where, what have you got to lose? You might as well try it. We all complain that there's not enough time in the day. What if there just isn't enough energy for us in the day anymore? Do you remember when we were kids? A day felt like a week. Because we were always doing something. Just my thoughts on it, folks. Give it a shot. Like I said, you can find the information at the link I just gave you a minute ago. What have you got to lose?
If you don't believe in God we trust, then strap your bomb to yourself and ride your camel out of here. You're listening to Eric Off the Rails with Double R right here on Common Ground Radio.
Bud Light presents Real American Heroes.
Real American Heroes.
Today we salute you, Mr. Footlong Hot Dog Inventor.
Mr. Footlong Hot Dog Inventor.
When conventional wisdom said no one could make a hot dog longer than 6 inches, you dared to dream.
Dared to dream.
You knew the limitations of a regular size hot dog bun, and you ignored them.
Can't stop me.
You made a 10-inch wiener, and people cheered.
Oh.
But you weren't satisfied. You said, wait, I think I can still give you 2 more inches.
Gotta want it.
And so the footlong was born. So crack open an ice cold Bud Light, Mr. Hot Dog Hero, because you gave every single one of us our fondest wish, a bigger wiener.
Oh, thank you, thank you, thank
Bud Light Beer, Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri.
All right, folks, and we're back. Sorry about that. I'm still working on trying to get that last little snippet I wanted to play uploaded. Give me just a sec. So, yeah, again, if you live anywhere in the Oklahoma area, if you haven't hit the store yet, you might wanna. Because, yeah, apparently the stores were nuts today. My wife actually works at one of the local grocery stores, and he had a really crappy day. Apparently, nobody thinks you're going to be able to get out of their house ever, ever again, so. Alright, so yeah, getting that queued up now. Sorry about that little bit of a delay there, but I just kind of thought after reading that article, this was kind of important, so.
We have... never invested as much in public education as we should have because we've always had kind of a private notion of children. Your kid is yours and totally your responsibility. We haven't had a very collective notion of these are our children. So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents or kids belong to their families and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. Once it's everybody's responsibility and not just the households, then we start making better investments.
Okay, so am I the only one who was completely terrified the first time you ever heard that from Melissa Harris Perry? And I'm sorry if that was your first time. I hope you weren't driving, because, that crap really freaked me out. I'm just saying, all of a sudden you got some MSLSD talking head chick going, children should be everyone's responsibility. No. I'm sorry. Most of the people that I know are crackheads. Sorry, getting a message. Okay. Message responded. Okay, so anyway. Yeah. A lot of the people that I know, I would consider crackheads. And even if I like you, it doesn't mean I want your input when it comes to raising my children. It does not take a village to raise a child. It does not take a group. And I'm sorry, as an American citizen, I'm never going to buy into this communal crap. Communal crap doesn't work. It had been tried. Jamestown. Research it. It was a commune. Hang on a second. Yes, that's not a bad idea. Hang on. Okay, so let's read this together. This is from Wikipedia. Jamestown was a settlement in the colony of Virginia, the first permanent English settlement in the Americas established by the Virginia Company of London as Jamesfort on May 24, 1607, May 14, 1607, and considered permanent after brief abandonment in 1610. It followed several earlier failed attempts, including the lost colony of Roanoke. Jamestown served as the capital of the colony for 83 years. The settlement was located within the territory of a political entity known as Sinamica, the state of Powhatan Confederacy, with around 14,000 native inhabitants, and specifically was in part a part of the subdivision. Hang on a second. So let me see if I'm right, because I've always heard this was one of the ones that was mentioned as being communal. So let's see if I can find information to that effect. Set sail on a charter from Virginia Company, established a colony in the New World after a particularly long voyage of 5 months. Duration, including a stop in Puerto Rico, they finally departed for the American mainland on April 10, 1607. Three ships named Susan Constant, Discovery, and Godspeed, under Captain Christopher Newport, made landfall on April 26, 1607, at a place they named Cape Hendry. Under orders to select a more secure location, they set about exploring what is now Hampton Roads and an outlet into the Chesapeake Bay. They named James River in honor of their king, James of England. On May 14, 1607, Captain Edward Maria Wingfield, elected president of the Governing Council on April 25th, selected a piece of land on a large peninsula some 40 miles inland from the Atlantic Ocean as a prime location for a fortified settlement. The peninsula was surrounded by the York River in the north, the James River in the south, and the Chesapeake Bay in the east of the peninsula. The piece of land had deep water, making it navigable. and defensible strategic point. Perhaps the best thing about it, from an English point of view, was that it was not inhabited by nearby Virginia Indian tribes, who regarded the site as too poor and remote for agriculture. However, the island was swampy and isolated, offered limited space, and was plagued by mosquitoes and brackish tidal river water, unsuitable for drinking. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, this is boring, and it's not what I thought it was going to be. Hang on a second. Let me keep digging. This is more what I was looking for. Okay. Did you know America was first established as a socialist community? Long before Karl Marx or Lenin, America had the first socialist experiment. It began back in the 1600s with the first English settlement in America at Jamestown. The Jamestown colony was established to bring profits and political influence back to investors in England. Jamestown wasn't designed to promote religious liberty or freedom. In fact, at one point, there was only one clergyman in Jamestown for over 1,300 settlers. In Jamestown, nobody owned property. For the first 4 years, all work was communal. Okay, so think about that for a second. For 4 years, no one owned property. Think about that for a second. That means, let's say you and your neighbors built a house. There, back in that time, was probably maybe one, maybe two rooms if you count the kitchen, and let's say there were 10 neighbors. At that point, all 10 of you shared that house. Now here's the scary part. As you continued to build houses, everything was communal. So that means even if you were the one who stayed in that house for a night, that doesn't necessarily mean that at some point someone else couldn't come in, knock on the door, and stay with you. Okay, so in Jamestown, nobody owned property for the first 4 years. All work was communal. All the harvest was centralized in a single storehouse, and as you might expect, since there was no reward for working harder, nobody did. Historians record that after 4 years, no crops were planted, houses were falling apart, and the prime occupation of the men was bowling in the streets. The Jamestown colony ultimately failed. In contrast, a few hundred miles to the north, the Pilgrims settled. Their reason for coming to America was faith and freedom. Duty was their common currency. They quickly abandoned the socialistic model of Jamestown and gave every member a plot of land. In just one year, in spite of losing half their members to a wintry, horrible death, Pilgrims of the Plymouth were so prosperous they were able to celebrate the first Thanksgiving. In 1621, Richard Winslow wrote from Plymouth back to England, stating, "I never in my life remember a more seasonable year than we have enjoyed. We are so far from want that we often wish you partakers of our plenty. You might, on our behalf, give God thanks, who had dealt so favorably with us." Faith and freedom versus socialism, no contest in the America of the 1600s. Okay, so again, let's just kind of go over that for a second. You had Jamestown, where basically it was the model of Marx. Everyone according to their ability, everyone in their need. So if you couldn't work, you didn't have to. But if you needed something, we were still going to make sure that you got it. It sounds great on paper. And I've even heard it touted before that in small groups it works. Jamestown would seem to disagree. No one owned property. Everybody, anytime they did any work in the fields, had to put everything into a central area, and then basically they got their portion as deemed. Now here's my question. Who decided who got what portion? Because I'm suddenly, you know, the dry little Wikipedia thing I was reading a moment ago mentioned a president or governor member of the colony. I'm wondering if his share was the same as everyone else's. Because this is the part that no one seems to understand. Everyone seems to think that capitalism is greedy. I've got news for you. Capitalism, when it works properly and is done properly, is one of the most magnanimous systems ever. Because basically what you're doing is you're giving everyone the ability to contribute and then take what they deserve from the contribution, not what you suddenly decide they need. That's how the free market is supposed to work. Free enterprise. That's what capitalism used to be called. I'm sorry, but to me, capitalism is a dirty word. It's no different than communism. Because capitalism makes it sound like all you're doing is chasing a dollar. Someone who's a follower of free enterprise is not chasing a dollar. I spend hours on this stuff. This isn't what pays me. I'm hoping at some point it may, but I don't do this because it makes me tons of money. I do this because I enjoy it. And I do this because it's a way that I can help feeling like even in my small little corner, I'm making a difference. And that's really all there is to it. If it never makes me more than it's making me right now, I'll still do it anyway, only because I enjoy it. But that doesn't mean that I haven't found a way to take care of my family, because I'll work at the day job I have until such time as this starts paying me, and then I'll make a decision. If it doesn't, then I will continue to do it anyway. But that's not the point. The point is, I saw something that I enjoyed, and I found a way to potentially turn it into a business. That's what free enterprise is about. It's about realizing there's a need and finding a way to meet that need. It's not about chasing a dollar. The dollars come as a side effect. When you do it right, when you truly are part of a free market, free enterprise system that works, even as a little niche like me, the money will take care of itself. That's the part that nobody seems to understand. It's like on one of the Facebook pages, the one that started all of it, which is now basically the namesake of our company, the Common Ground page. Someone posted on there the other day about minimum wage, and then the conversation turned into, well, not everyone judges their worth by the money that they bring in. And that's true. I'm that way. But that doesn't mean that I don't do whatever I can do to make sure that my family has what they need. I don't care if I ever make more than $50,000 or $60,000 a year. That doesn't mean if the opportunity presents itself, I won't avail myself of it. But it means I don't let my paycheck define me. That much I agree with. But then the conversation started spiraling. Suddenly it started becoming mandatory minimum wage hikes or distribution or other conversation points along the lines of distribution that came up, none of which are helpful or even make any sense. Because I've said it over and over and over again. I've now lived through a total of 2 minimum wage hikes. Actually, I'm sorry, 3 minimum wage hikes. Because it went from like $4.50 to $5.15 to $5.50 and now $7.25, I think, is the national right now. $7.25, $7.50. Well, from the $4.50 to $5.15, I was a cashier at McDonald's at that time. And basically, everything in the store shot up overnight by around anywhere between a nickel and a dime. So then, about a year or so later, I think is when it jumped up to around the $5.50 mark. Well, by then, I was one of the assistants of the store. And again, everything jumped up by anywhere from nickel, dime to 15 cents. Now, by the time it went to $7.50, I think is where it's at now, I was the owner of a business. Well, during that time, I was already paying people well above the $5.50 minimum. Because I worked in the security industry, and I felt like if you were going to be working with me, you deserved to make a decent wage. Well, the thing that nobody took into account, and even after hundreds of hours of arguing the point on one of our Facebook pages, still no one takes into account, is as a small business owner who was trying to make a name for myself, I had to undercut the margins of everyone else who'd had the properties before me to try to come in and take them. Anyway, sorry. But anyway, so where was I? Sorry, I got distracted. Really? Pardon me, I'm being distracted. Okay, yeah, sorry. JT was messaging me wanting to know if I'd had a chance to listen to today's show, and I'm like, no, because I'm currently doing mine. Anyway, so, dang it, now I lost my train of thought. Oh yeah, where was I? Oh yeah, let's see. Oh yeah, as business owner, minimum wage went to $7.50. Yeah, my whole business pretty much died, cause I was all ready to come in and basically try to get my foot in the door. Was cutting profit margins as low as I possibly could, and then still trying to pay people decent amounts of money, which were still in most cases above the $7.50 mark. Even then, most of my staff, unless they were working on a conditional license, was making between $8 and $8.25 an hour. Anyway, so again, was paying anywhere between $8 and $8.25 an hour. So then the minimum wage hike came along, and suddenly these guys are making 75 cents to maybe a dollar more an hour than the minimum wage, whereas they were making nearly $3 an hour more before, and suddenly they're wanting a raise. Well, because of my profit margins, I couldn't give them a raise without going back to the clients and saying, hey, we've been here for a while, and because of the minimum wage hike, I'd really like to be able to give my guys some more money, and four times out of five, I was basically told to go fly a kite. So shortly thereafter, my business folded, and since then, I have been working in call centers, while also, over the last year, slowly trying to get this built. So, anyway. So, yeah. Again, just one of those things, because anytime the government tries to step in with what they think is a good idea, there's always lovely unintended consequences. Lovely, lovely unintended consequences. So again, I ask you pretty much the same thing I asked you at the beginning of the show. Do you trust your government? And if you do, why? Because I just don't get it anymore. So just to kind of let you focus a little bit and let you kind of go out the same way we came in, I'm going to play a few things for you again, kind of back to back. At least a couple of things. So, this is why, one of the reasons, again, why I don't trust my government, and we've talked about this at the beginning of the show. I just want to make sure that it stays fresh in your mind now that the show's coming to a close.
Congress is doing right now is important. Unfortunately, right now the debate that's going on in Congress is not meeting the test of helping middle-class families. It's just they're not focused on you. They're focused on politics. They're focused on trying to mess with me. If Congress doesn't pass this debt ceiling in the next few weeks, the United States will default on its obligations. That's never happened in American history. Basically, America becomes a deadbeat.
Okay, guys, I've got to go vote. We are voting on the budget today. It's a sad state of affairs. We just voted to increase the debt limit. The U.S. total debt at this point exceeds $8 trillion. That's 8 trillion with a T. So we've got to get our fiscal house in order here in Washington. I'm not sure it's going to happen under the current leadership in Congress.
You know, folks, I gotta say, I was so busy listening to him basically kind of pull things out of his butt during that last part, I missed it when I played it the first time, which is why I've kind of decided that I'm gonna start ending the show with some of the clips that I play throughout the show, just to give you guys another chance to listen to them to see if the same thing happens with you. I really, really like the fact that there at the very end, he started talking about how we need to get our fiscal house in order. Sorry, I'm trying not to laugh and choke on air at the same time. He literally said, we need to get our fiscal house in order. Mr. President, you've had nearly 6 years. If anything, our fiscal house is in more disarray than it's ever been. Thanks for playing. Let's move along. And of course, I want to go ahead and close out with one other little piece. And sorry for anybody that this gives nightmares to, but again, it was kind of creepy, and I think it's important.
We have never invested as much in public education as we should have, because we've always had kind of a private notion of children. Your kid is yours and totally your responsibility. We haven't had a very collective notion of these are our children. So part of it is we have to break through our kind of private idea that kids belong to their parents or kids belong to their families and recognize that kids belong to whole communities. Once it's everybody's responsibility and not just the households, then we start making better investments.
All right, so at this point, we're going to go ahead and start wrapping things up here. It's getting to be a little late. wifey poo's knocking on the door wanting to know when I'm going to be closing up shop, so we're about to call it a night. Just wanted to, again, leave you with that little bit from Miss Melissa Harris-Perry, Scariest Thing I've Ever Heard, next to the Wicked Witch of the West from the Wizard of Oz screaming, "I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too." We should probably put a parody together of that. "I'll get you, my pretty, and all of your little children, too." Just saying. Anyway. Okay, so at this point, we are going to go ahead and call it a night. We will be back again probably about the same time tomorrow. And it has been my pleasure. We're going to start trying to get back to 5 nights a week. Station owner has been having kittens because things haven't gone as planned since the first of the year. So we're going to do everything we can to try to get back on track here. And I know for a fact that the Family Factor is coming along for the ride. Some of the other shows are in a bit of influx right now, but we are working some things out. America Off the Rails and the Family Factor will still be a regular part of the programming, and the rest of it, I gotta see about getting the rest of my team kicked into gear here at Common Ground Media Group and see what their plans are. But that is gonna do it for today. There was something else I was gonna play on the way out, and I can't find it now. Oh yeah, here we go. "Helps if I pay attention to the buttons." We'll see you folks not coming back in after this little bit. You have a great night. We'll be back tomorrow. For those of you in Oklahoma or the surrounding, Oklahoma City or the surrounding areas, if you haven't gone to the store yet, you might want to go now.
Hi, this is Denny C. for the Family Factor, praying that this new year will bring more strength, joy, hope, and love to you and your family. This show is about looking deeply into the modern-day issues that affect your family and mine. So please tune in each weekday here on K98Talk.com, and I hope you'll get some answers to the factors within your family.
Leagues of Talk Radio, right here on the all-new K98 Talk.